Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, Mayor.
Let me open up by saying that as I look into the crowd, see a lot of familiar faces. On Friday, this group came to my office unannounced. And it's hard for the mayor to meet with people if they come unannounced. The one thing this administration and myself pride ourselves on, if you call us, we will make an appointment and we will see you. We can have that attestment with Reverend Rivera's here. She can tell you, whenever you call, have you gotten appointments to come in and see the mayor?
Yes, I've always gotten
always
an appointment.
And that's the way we try. We're here to represent the people. We can accept the bitter and the sweet. I can say on 2 weeks ago, and this is with me where some of the confusion may have lied. 2 weeks ago, I met with the group, and sometimes these groups, you guys are intermingled. I'm thinking this group is just the group, and now I'm finding out that there's five, six groups split. So forgive me for assuming that the group that I met with 2 weeks ago was y'all, because it had representation of y'all there in that meeting. So I have since found out that meeting, that group, and this group is not the same group, even though you have like associations. So Marissa, forgive me for that, because I assume they were representing you. And because we had Reverend Rivera, she was there. We had a lady from the visiting nurses. I'm just off the top of my head. Remember some of the people that was there. So forgive me for assuming that then they would go back, because I thought you would be at that meeting also. That's what happens when I assume you. And then, or these ambassadors will go back and take the message to the group as a whole. So now that I'm aired that is clear, that is clear. Also, I would like to take this time to say any members of the press is here. Okay, we got one there. Want to make sure that we give you guys a timeline of events to show what this administration have done. We have put forth hundreds and hundreds of hours of dealing with this since it was first revealed to us in May, and we went into a crisis mode to deal with the people and this situation. And when I picked up the paper the other day and they tried to say this administration has not done anything, I thought that was insult at the least, because we have given timelines to the newspaper, and we're going to also pass some of this into the audience so you can see what we've done with boots on the ground, with how many meetings that I've been. I've talked to congressmen about this problem. I had a meeting 2 weeks ago with the lieutenant governor, the second highest elected official in the state of Indiana. I've sat and had meetings with the highest health person, Dr. Jerome Adams. You know, he's the czar of health in Indiana. So sometimes when people loosely throw it out there and say you haven't done something, you know, at best, I chalk it up to just misinformation. But the one thing I expect that we get informed reporting. So at this time, since I don't really know who the okay. Then we're going to open it up.
Oh, please, because we have an agenda.
But no, wait a minute. Let me speak on that. You asked for a meeting. Well, I did an emergency meeting to have here, because we're winding up on a four-day weekend to where the city is going to shut down for 4 days. But I said, we're not going to let people go into the holiday without having their grievances heard. Now, I was told, again, reading in the newspaper, that you guys say you left a list of demands. There was no such list. So now that we're coming to talk to you today, we couldn't even prepare. We couldn't even begin to know what you're going to ask us or have some preparation. So the rules of engagement is going to be here today, is that nothing get lost in translation.
I'm not sure that I understand that. This group came. These are the citizens. When I met with you 2 weeks ago, it was in fact, or the Federation, it was in fact LULAC, it was in fact the Ministerial Alliance, National Nurses United, and we took that back to the group of residents. There are a number of groups that are a part of this process. This particular group that came last Friday is the strategy group. We are the group that's organizing the strategies on the ground.
But at least we should get the courtesy of you guys scheduling a meeting with us so I can have people who that can answer your questions. I mean, to just the blindside us and then say that we ain't there to...
The meeting on Friday was not a meeting. All they wanted to do was to drop off. If they were not able to meet with you, to drop off a list of demands.
As a point of order, we need to know who we are actually meeting.
And that's where I was heading to.
A strategy group for what, the community advisory group?
We are a strategy group for the lead crisis involving all of those.
Are you part of what, because there's a community advisory group that applies to the EPA for funding. There are other groups who have intervened in the federal consent decree case.
Correct.
There are other groups that are part of the plaintiff's attorney suit against the city.
Mm-hmm.
So when you say your strategy group.
We are a number of people from all of those groups are a part of this. We are independent in that we are not associated with the EPA. We're not associated with the consent decree. There are folks who are
Are you saying that no one in this room is part of any of that litigation?
There are some people who may be a part of that litigation. Yes, or there may be,
part of the community advisory group as well.
There are people here from the community advisory group as well. That's correct. There are people here from Calumet or Lives Matter. There are people here from, so that all of those various segments, but the strategy group organizes strategy on the ground. We are independent. Whereas the CAG is affiliated with the EPA or comes under.
The CAG under federal law is not affiliated with the EPA. It's an outside group that applies under the CERCLA law for funding
right.
The EPA, but you're not affiliated with it.
We are not a member, but there are members of the CAG who are a part of the strategy group. We are an independent community group. The Federation is a member. A number of folks are a member, and we are organizing the strategy on the ground.
Okay. So again, let me take back on the comment. Again, what I would like to see happen today is that since we didn't get this list of demands, and demands is really a wrong word, let's say concern and cares, that today, that nothing gets lost in translation, that we sit here and we hear every concern that you have so that now we can deal with it decent and in order, because since we had nothing to go off of to build your questions and to answer them, so sometimes it's hard to do it in real time, but we want to make sure we have all of your grievances for that.
Okay. So
Reverend Guru, please begin.
Yes. Having said that, my name is Reverend Shelby Vera, and I'm the Executive Director and Lead Organizer for the Northwest Indiana Federation of Interfaith Organizations, and I'm a member of the Community Strategy Group. We called this meeting so that the residents and the community would have an opportunity to present their concerns to the mayor. I do have extra copies of the agenda and the demands that we can pass out. And I would like to call on Akeisha Daniels, who is going to chair this meeting for us. Akeisha is from Zone 1. And after everybody.
Good afternoon, Mayor.
Good afternoon.
Thank you all for meeting with us this evening. My name is Akeisha Daniels, and I am a lifelong resident of West Calumet, East Chicago, Indiana. I'm part of the strategy team. We the members of the community strategy group on behalf of the individuals and families living in the USS Lead Superfund site demand the following actions to secure the health, safety, and well-being of all residents exposed to toxic lead, arsenic, and other poisons for decades. I will call up Mr. Ray Mosley, who's a lifelong resident of Zone 3.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Thanks for meeting with us. My name is Ray Mosley, I'm of Zone 3, and my topic is emergency declaration. Okay, we demand that Mayor Anthony Copeland issue an emergency declaration for all residents living in the USS-led Superfund site in East Chicago, Indiana. We recognize and appreciate that you blew the whistle informing everyone about the great severity of lead and arsenic soil contamination in West Cayman, and that you decided that the health risk was too great for residents to continue living in unsafe and unhealthy conditions while ETA did its cleanup. However, City of East Chicago does not have the fiscal resources, staffing, or personnel power to address the public health crisis and environmental catastrophe that the residents are coming face to face with every single day. The USS-led Superfund site is a man-made catastrophic health and environmental disaster. We need our mayor to acknowledge it and declare it as such. Thousands of individuals and families live and have lived in crisis for 4 decades. Enough is enough. On Sunday, November 20th, 2016, in a meeting at a residence in Zone 3, Congressman Peter Laskowski was asked to support Superfund residents' demand to declare the entire Superfund site as a state of emergency. The Congressman responded, "It is an emergency, so we say why not officially declare it as such?" Okay, thank you.
My name is, again, is Akeisha Daniels, and I'm from Zone 1, and I'm speaking on funding and relocation. We demand the Mayor Copeland divert the $8 million funding that has been requested for the federal government for West Calumet public housing demolishing to instead address the immediate housing needs of individuals and families who will be displaced or relocated, and without delay to guarantee that. A, deposits for moving are paid immediately upon a residence locating suitable housing. B, that all application fees are paid directly to landlords rather than residents having to pay for application fees and then receiving reimbursement. C, the city hires healthcare professionals and social service professionals to do door-to-door good home checks and assessments to make sure that every person in all three zones are checked for toxic poisoning. D, renters in zones 1, 2, and 3 be evacuated into comparable temporary housing or new mobile double-wide homeland security trailers until remediation of the land is completed and comparable permanent housing secured. Residents do not wish to be forced to the Harbor Apartments or Chicago crime-ridden areas, which is where most public housing is located. There may be ordinance restrictions to overcome for every temporary mobile home unit in the city. Priority housing must be allocated for zones 1 renters. Nevertheless, renters are experiencing enough with the disaster and uncertainties and demands to be treated with respect and dignity at the East Chicago Housing Office. Next, we'll have Marissa Lopez speaking from Zone 3.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Mm-hmm.
And look at the one with the king. How's everyone doing?
Good.
Okay. Everybody here knows me. Good afternoon. I'm going to speak on healthcare, and I guess it's very evident why. Mayor, come upon front everyone, and how are you? And not only yourself, but the full administration, I'm going to bring it that way, because it's not solely your responsibility. But as a lifelong resident here in East Chicago, we demand the support that the residents of the USS-led Superfund site are demanding state and federal legislative actions to secure Medicare for all, for life, for all residents living in all zones 1, 2, and 3 in the Superfund site. Right now, the residents are reporting, and we call it stage cancers, and the reason being is because they're happening right away, such as colon, liver, lung, breast, and brain cancers, and all other manner of diseases, such as severe neuropathy, ADHD, seizures, brittle bone disease, breathing, respiratory problems, severe neurological diseases, cardiology problems where the arteries blow, blood disorders, and severe disabilities, and a lot of afflictions where deaths of loved ones occur right away without no cause. In West Calumet, Calumet, and East Calumet. Right now, the residents face ongoing lifelong health care needs, and I'm proof of that. However, as circumstances change, residents should not have to worry if they can afford health care coverage, qualifying for Medicaid, or pay out of their pocket. Health care costs are increasing cost of drugs. We know Medicare for All of Life can happen. Right now, Senator Max Baucus secured Medicare for All for Life for current and former residents in Libby, Montana. Vermiculite mines in Libby, Montana gave the residents jobs and helped the local community. However, due to the mine's high use of asbestos, the residents suffered related disorders, just as mesothelioma. Because of the mine's activities that started back in 1919, residents continue suffering until today. Buried deep in the health reform law, section 10.323, it amends the Social Security Act to extend Medicare coverage to individuals exposed to environmental health hazards in the region defined by the Emergency Declaration of June 17, 2009. This declaration limits the benefit to the area around Libby, Montana. Section 10.323 of the Affordable Care Act, ACA, calls it deeming of individuals as eligible for Medicare benefits. People do not have to be age 65 or wait 2 years following disability or have to pay into the Medicare system. The victims of asbestos in the Libby situation were simply deemed to be eligible for Medicare. It was described as discretionary deeming. We need discretionary deeming so all who live in the USS Lead Superfund site can get Medicare for all. I am begging you, we are already on the national priorities list. It is already a state of emergency, which you can do. If we could unite together, let's do this.
Thank you.
Next, we'll have Sarah Jimenez from Zone 3.
We demand Mayor Copeland that the residents of East Chicago and Calumet who own homes and protect and make whole in the USS Lead Superfund. We are 100% supportive of the needs and attention given to West Calumet public housing. At the same time, the needs and interest of homeowners have not been adequately addressed or even considered. Homeowners in the USS Lead Superfund site are concerned about loss of value in their homes because of high toxic levels of lead and arsenic in the soil, which our homes stand. We are not informed that our homes were built on lead and arsenic and other toxins. Homeowners must be provided necessary funds to relocate if they so desire, and their homes must be bought out at pre-Superfund designated values that allow them to relocate without financial loss. In the 1940s, 21,000 tons of toxic industrial waste containing highly toxic dioxins were buried by Hooker Chemical, now Occidental Petroleum Corporation, which led to an adverse effect on nearby residents of Love Canal. The Love Canal neighborhood started gaining international attention as the health impact of such pollution became evident that miscarriages, cancer, birth defects, and has been described as a national symbol of failure to exercise a sense of concern for future generations. Under Governor Kerry's personal direction, state agencies moved swiftly to ease the suffering associated with Love Canal. The government asked President Carter to declare the area eligible for federal disaster assistance, a request which was granted and enlisted and received the support of Senator Daniel Patrick and Jacob John LaFlas and others in Washington in expediting the approval of federal assistance. Eventually, 800 homes in Love Canal were bought out by the federal government in the Love Canal, and all the families relocated at no expense to them. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor.
Next one.
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. We did not intend for buyers or buyers. We did not intend to buy our homes on land contaminated with lead and arsenic and other toxins. There are 586 properties in Zone 2 and 463 properties in Zone 3. We need to know how the man-made environmental emergency will impact us. The homeowners want to be made whole. Just like everyone else, we are reaching out to the tax assessors to help determine the value. I'm sorry.
Valuation.
Okay. And taxes for our homes. Next, we'll have Sarah Willis, who is a resident of Zone 2.
Hi, how's everybody doing today?
Hello.
Thank you. We demand Mayor Copeland development and public release of comprehensive strategy plan, making the people and the land whole in the USS Lead Superfund Zone 1, 2, and 3. There continue to be confusion and not clear direction who is doing what. We need comprehensive plan that is transparent and communication and communicate to all residents door to door with professional staff. Can you tell where we can get a detailed comprehensive plan from the city of Chicago?
Thank you very much, sir.
Next we have Charlene Lowe, who is a resident of the Nicosia Senior Building.
I'm asking you, in the name of Jesus, I'm coming before you all in the name of Jesus today. We demand Mayor Copeland that the EPA and the CDC be notified that the residents of the Nicosia Senior Building has been tested positive for lead. As seniors, we are considered vulnerable populations. We want immediate opportunities to move with vouchers, just like the other vulnerable East Chicago residents suffering exposure to lead and arsenic contamination. We demand on-site and lead testing for lead and arsenic at the John B. Nicosia Building for the people and the property. We demand that the John B. Nicosia Building be added to the USS Lead Superfund site, the building proximity to Superfund sites. Residents testing positive for lead and residents suffering with various cancer and unknown diseases. We demand a moratorium on rent. This continues because residents are living in a building that has been deemed unsafe property by the city building inspector, pertinent to City Code 3365, as of March 2016. The building is infested with rodents, roaches, contaminated mold, and numerous leaks and unsafe for vulnerable senior citizens.
Thank you, sir.
So, Mayor and other staff, these are the concerns that are presented by the residents of the Superfund. I do believe that a shorter version of our demands were given to Irene on Friday.
Okay.
All right. If that did not happen, perhaps that was an oversight because that was the intent. Okay, so we want to make sure that you have these. And
I have it on video.
Response to these in a timely manner. We know that you all are working on this. Do you have some idea of when you might be able to give us a response just to these demands here?
Well, like with everything, we're doing as fast as we can do it well. The good thing is a lot of these issues are being addressed as we speak. The common thread or theme that I see going on and some of the concerns that you have. Again, like I said, I'm trying to stray away from demand. You know, that's confrontational when we're all in the same boat together. The common thread that I see even in your concerns and the things you want us to address is that you see it goes across agencies. You see it takes a combination of state agencies, federal agencies. The city of East Chicago alone cannot solve
this problem.
You notice that even the federal government, they have the ability to print money, but even they are gravitating towards seeking to try to find the deepest pockets to go into. When you see the Atlanta Richfields and the different ones, they trying to go back in the past and say, well, you straddled us with this legacy cost, then you and kind should pay for the cleanup. This is not easy. It's not gonna be done with the wave of a hand. I look at this thing and sometimes I'm humbled by it because at some of the most beautiful times in my life, 1972, 73, I was a senior in high school, probably most wonderful time in my life, okay, when they was putting the buildings up there. So you can see this is a disaster that's 43 years in the making. I can't tell you what people, why, and when, and what they could have done in the past. I only can just tell you that when we were armed with the data, And some of the simple nature in this is some people sat on the data and did not give us the comprehensive data that we needed, did not give us the detail. But once it was revealed, it was just hard for me to believe that when they said emergency cleanup should happen, I mean that cleanup should happen at anything above. And then when they finally revealed and gave us all the details from each of the borings that they have done over the years in May, and I saw there was areas that was 91,000 parts per million. And it's not easy. And I've been trained, okay? I was fired for 27 and a half years, did rescue, I was EMT. I've been trained to deal with disaster. Hazmat technician and everything. So I was able to look at this and I could say, I just don't see how you're gonna be able to do this. I don't see how you're gonna be able to disturb this massive amount of earth and not cause irreparable harm added upon the irreparable harm that have already happened. And this is why we took the drastic step that we took. We knew logistically that it wasn't gonna be able to happen overnight. We knew it was gonna be tight, but something had to make them act. And it took putting the truth in front of them and reveal to them what they have done to us over the years. I want to share with you that when I talked with Region 5, the highest authority of Region 5 of EPA, he told me, and Carly could attest to this, when I asked him that we didn't want him to do the cleanup in place, he told me, he said, I can emphatically tell you that will not happen. We are going to clean up in place. When we got and we addressed the letters and we told them on how they settled on the information, and we sent this letter to President Obama, we sent it to Piskowski. We sent it to all of the Indiana elected officials. We sent it to all of Region 5. We sent it to all of Obama cabinet. When we fired off this letter, showing how they had misled even the city of East Chicago, how they had even misled the people over this length of time, then all of a sudden, when this man put up his hand, he said, across this nation, he can put up his hand and have fingers up how they have ever went away from cleaning up in place. And he told me emphatically, it will not happen. It's happening now. That they had to back up when we revealed to them the atrocities that you have done over this length of time to each and every person in the city of East Chicago. This is not hard. I mean, this is not easy, folks. This is not easy. But the one thing I can tell y'all, and what I asked Reverend Rivera and the lady from Visiting Nurses, I told them that sooner or later, this fight is going to be fought in the courts. And the only thing that's going to empower us is if we are armed with the data, the testing results, the things that they denied us over the years. And I simply ask for your group help and the multitude of groups that are out there. Right now, we have in Zone 1, we have a population that's right now that's contained there. Sooner or later, now they've been in power. We fought for them to get the vouchers. We fought for the relocation. HUD did not want to release that easily. We had to fight for those things. Did I beat my chest and ask for the Channel 2, 5, 7 to be there? That's not necessary. That's not necessary. I quietly do my job, and I do it. If you can't see in the morning, you can't see at night. Don't need no proof. I don't need to be in front of the press. Don't need, just get it done. That's what the people want to see. So at the end of the day, when we do not get this data across all three of these zones, and people start leaving, and then when we got to do these court battles, because sooner or later, the one thing will happen, we may not clearly see the ability that we're all on the same boat, but it's going to be, that's going to be painfully apparent that you, I, and all the residents of East Chicago have suffered this, are going to have to come together in one accord, and we're going to have to fight a united front. And we only can do that with armed data, armed test results. And that's why when we started off, and they said they was going to dig in place, and he told me no way they were going to back away from it, I ordered our health department to take emergency funding, and we're going to test everybody. I literally, my staff, we literally took consent forms, knocked on every door in West Guyman to tell the kids, go get your kids lead tested. So when they disturb this earth, we can have a before and an after. Because that's what this is all going to be about. When you sit up there and you go before this court, they're going to want to know the facts. They ain't going to want to know the hearsay, and we think this person might have been sick, because they're going to want to know how. How did the exposure happen? And when we can show over the years, they've done this, they've been in our community over the years and the dug test holes, they've even cleaned some areas, but they never told us in detail the concentrations of what we was dealing with. And just think about it. It takes a lot for me, the highest elected official in the city, to tell somebody to leave out of their home. That's illogical. Politically, that's suicide. For me to tell these very people that I want to vote for me, that now they have to move out, they have to go to another city. But the cause was bigger than me. And when I seen those results, I said, no, you're not going to be in place. So we want, and what I'm asking the group simultaneously, bring us your demands. We're going to look at it. And a lot of this, I'm seeing a couple of things that we did not see. So you're up on your homework. You're doing positive things. I'm saying that at some point, let's not be divided. Let's keep our eye on the prize on who are we truly fighting and where the monies are and how do we tap into the money. I showed you fans, I read it in the paper, and it said, almost as if I'm not compassionate, I bleed East Chicago. Every pore in my body oozes East Chicago. I love East Chicago with all my heart, my soul, my liver, my kidney, my pancreas. And for me to see someone say that, it's $8 million up there, as if the mayor, it was $8 million up there, and the mayor can decide how he was going to use this $8 million, and he did not want to use it toward health care, he did not want to use it toward relocation. The $8 million that we saw was coming from the hardest hit fund. This money is designed solely for demolition only, can't be used for anything else. That portion of the money that was getting out of the hardest hit. So to sit up there and say the mayor was requesting $8 million and he wasn't going to give it to the people, he was just going to do it for them, that was just one source of funding that was sole source that we went after, and we was asking them to put us in the front row because of these millions that's there for the demolition. Hammond can ask for one. Gary can ask for one. We went through one round already before we even knew about the crisis. We got $1.3 million from the hardest hit in the first round before this crisis even hit. But it was for demolition only across the city of East Chicago. Now they had a second round of these funds sitting up there. Now they asked us to put an application, and we all say, what I need is, and Gary, they plead, woes me, my woes, works in East Chicago, and Gary got $6 million last time. You see? So we have to ask them why, and why not ask them for all of these units over there at the end of the day, why should we let these buildings stay idle as a reminder of the atrocities that happen to us. At the same time that we look for the permanent remedies for housing, we should also remove the scars of the past so our children are not reminded of that, because they would leave those structures standing. And I'll give you a for instance. We got two fire gutted buildings right here on Pennsylvania. Totally gutted. Useless. I've been asking HUD how many years? 5 years to give me the permission to tear down the eyesores that our kids can go into. The building can literally collapse because structurally it's unsafe. I've yet got permission. So I know how long those can stand up there. I know how you can have a pool of money that's set aside for something else, and just as that pool is there and is flourished with funding, it can dry up tomorrow. So what did I do? I sit up there and say, Gary, Hammond, none of their situation is more dire than ours. Give us, out of these untold millions you got, give us the $8 million to remove that problem. So that's what that was. So do it hurt? Hey, I got feelings too. I cry too. Do I like it when I see something, when somebody wants to sit up there and say, I didn't have the compassion for the very people I serve? That hurts. So let the record show that that's what that $8 million is for. We have petitioned the state. I had somebody tell me that Governor Pence, who is still governor now, he's going to soon to be our vice president, that he hadn't visited. And people wanted to spin it and say, well, you know, he went to Kokomo, but he didn't come to East Chicago. And they wanted to spin that racial tone on it. And I told people, I said, he was not here in person, but he was here in the spirit, because he sent us a whole panel of his experts to come here and show us. So why would I throw him under the bus? See, some people think you just throw people under the bus, you let whatever come out your mouth. But how do you damn the same people that you now need help? We base it on truth and we base it on fact. But let me show you what I'm hoping that our concerns and us in need of funding, and all funding will from the federal government will go through the state. The hardest hit is money that's coming out of the U.S. Treasury. They send it to the state. We have to petition the state to tell them to release the money to us. No one is going to release money at the federal level directly to the city of Chicago. But a wonderful thing happened since then. I mean, the political season is over with. We all know it was stormy from national on here to the state of Indiana. There's been radical change. But at the same time, I think those who have compassion, those who have taken the oath to serve the people, will always serve the people. When I asked the second round, I went and I whispered to Congressman Biskowski and other elected officials who 10 years, way longer than mine, who've been around longer than me, who's made friends, and have asked them to reach out. I asked them a second round, can I get to the governor? Because when the governor called for disaster relief, that money comes down from the federal government to the state level. That's what happened in Flint. The governor of Flint declared a disaster area, and that's where they tapped into the EPA funding to the tune of $60 million. So I asked for a favor. Would you please, on my behalf, talk to the governor from your lips to his ears? The governor going all across the nation. He running for vice president. In and out, round and round. The second time I asked for him, I still didn't get the governor. But I got the second highest elected official in the state of Indiana, Lieutenant Governor Holcomb came and met with us 2 hours. And again, I don't look and say leadership should have a D or R branded. You just search for leadership. When we sat, I felt the sincerity in him, and he went back. He's looking to some things now. We've given him the period to transition, because now he's not only the lieutenant governor, now he is the governor-elect. So at the time when I thought I was pleading my case to the lieutenant governor, I was talking to the governor. And at the time I thought I was pleading my case to the governor of Indiana, I was pleading my case to the vice president of the United States. And just as I shot the letter to Obama, my new letter would go to newly elected President Trump, asking him about my plight. It may be beauty in it all when Trump picks this up and says, I got this letter from this guy, this mayor in East Chicago, Indiana, Is he from Indiana? You know this guy from Indiana?
Does he? Yeah, I know him.
You see, so we're hoping that in the ensuing weeks that we start making our requests, and we're going to humbly ask for these requests. We know that cabinet moves are going to be made. Donald Trump is in position to create 400 and 700 new jobs. A lot of shaking is going on in the next few weeks. When the dust settles, we're going to know who we'll be talking. We may be dealing with new people who got just a whole different idea and strategy on how they want to serve. But the one thing we have done, we have laid the seeds to cross the lines and say, this is not a Republican problem. This is not a Democratic problem. This is a people problem. And so I'm hoping in the soon weeks that the investment that we've made, the efforts that we've made to reach across the aisle and reach to those who have been empowered by people, that we come together and we start finding the funding. When they started off, they said it's going to take $23 million to clean this up in Zone 1. Now they say even Zone 1 itself maybe $50 million. So East Chicago could never tackle this. But we are, and this is what I like about what you gave me. You've given me some cases across the United States when there was catastrophic events that happened to the people, and they stepped up and went into the deepest vaults of this federal government and released the funds for relief for the people. So, and this is what I'm saying, that I hope what comes out of this meeting, that we enter into a new spirit of, I am your brother and you is my sister, and we are family, and we in the same boat. Okay? So, again, I would like to thank you guys for enlightening me on some of the cases that you have here.
And we can provide even more information, and we just need to say that the residents, all of the folks here have been seeking you as an ally. You are the greatest ally mm-hmm. that we could possibly mm-hmm. have. Mm-hmm. I don't believe there's anybody who is involved in this fight, whether they are part of the lawsuit or not, who does not have the best interest of the city at hand and realize that you are the greatest ally that we can possibly have. Mm-hmm. So that we have come in that spirit, also knowing that as public officials, we hold public officials accountable. And it does not mean that we're seeking to divide anything, but we know mm-hmm. that we are stronger together. Mm-hmm. And we're going to continue to push because the residents have that right. Okay?
And, you are the person. And I give you an example. When the Shriver Center?
Yeah, the Shriver Center.
When the Shriver Center came in and all like that, people may think that should have been an opposing factor that came here, this and that and that. It was a matter of good cop, bad cop. It was some things we were asking her and all like this and then said, well, give the people this and that and that, and let's waive the deposits and if it's damaging the union, let's waive that too and that. And some of this followed that in. I'm sure I was there, able to add some pressure on Absolutely. One side and say some things Absolutely. That we can't say. You see what I'm saying? So it was just an union, good cop, bad cop, and going like that. But one thing happened. The things that needed to happen, that we were quietly saying behind the scenes asking to happen, with another push coming from another place, it allowed it to be seen and to be heard. Because they went and fought it from another level in the courts or representing the people as a whole in another factor. But I told you, all roads is going to lead to the maximum remedy coming out of here is going to be through the courts. Us fighting in courts, people fighting us in court, saying we are to blame. But sooner or later, all roads is going to lead to the compensation and the relief coming through the court system. That's what I believe.
Okay.
Marissa?
Mayor, I just want to let everybody know, I don't know if you're aware, but now as of recent, in East Calumet, which you know is
yes.
how EPA divided at Zone 3, they are now finding high levels of lead and arsenic inside the homes based
mm-hmm.
on pilot programs,
mm-hmm.
And that's highly upsetting right now, and they haven't tested. One of the other concerns that we are upset about is there's no tracking system set up for the people that are leaving,
mm-hmm.
medical tracking system.
Well, that's not entirely true.
Right, but that we don't know.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying. I haven't got.
We're sitting with the state
right.
as we speak, and again,
And that, as a resident, this is what I want to say.
Okay.
the main issue, and I have fought it here at the council meetings, mm-hmm. is there has been failure to disseminate information mm-hmm. to us, the residents, who are the ones living on this poison.
Well,
and it's our concerns. We're the ones who have lost. We're getting different stories from different agencies, and here you're speaking and you're making negotiations, which we know nothing about, mm-hmm. but we're coming into these homes. Mm-hmm. We are upset as it is. Mm-hmm. We're finding all this out. We see them digging out there. We're all this stuff. It is upsetting. And it is very upsetting, and here we're finding out it took people showing up at your office to get this.
No, it didn't.
What I'm saying, to finally pull the...
Don't say that. You showed up unannounced. And walked away with nothing.
Yeah, that's it.
We had already been meeting. We just met with Reverend Rivera. Like I told you, but the one thing, you can't have all these splinter groups, and then they all look the same, because when you meet, I'm looking at the same people, and I told you, forgive me for assuming that all of y'all was one. I didn't know you had separate leadership and all like that, but... You know,
we
can get around it now, because I know sometimes I guess you can be separate, but cool. I don't know. But I know this one problem is going to bring us all together, that I do know.
It's the same cause.
And now I know that we have instrumented in place this advisory group that is communication across all of them.
Yep.
So I know how to assimilate this information out.
Yep.
Okay? I know how. So, but the one thing I want to tell you that I'm going to let the health department speak on this is that, again, it's not let us be lost that we need, and this is the thing that saddens me in all of this, is that we haven't even put a dent. Even in Zone 3, we beg the parents and family, please bring your kids in. Please bring your kids in. Because these are going to be the ones that when a judge hears someone full of life, and their life will be altered over the course of their life, that's when you're going to get the maximum return on the harm. Those in their life, you see, I've had compassion for that too. Somebody going to look and say, well, you live a long, good life. Well, somebody else, they got to carry these deficits across their lifetime that may hinder their employment, that may hinder how they rise in education, huh? How good their health is, or the quality of their life is. This is where we'll get the maximum. And if we allow this population to leave without being able to get them on tests, we got mobile testing. We've set up testing in carrier. We set up testing in the school system. We set up testing in 151. We've set up testing in the health department. We sat down with the EPA, and here's a letter they sent out detailing what they found at the boring they did there. We made them say, any information you send out to an individual resident, please do this. You may be exposed to other sources of lead, including pain and plumbing. Children ages 6 years and younger are particularly at risk. Blood lead testing is the only way to tell if a person has been exposed to high amounts of level. The East Chicago Health Department offers free testing. So through multimeter, Facebook, Twitter, through our channel 21 that scrolls 365 days, 24/7, we sent this message out. We've knocked on doors. We've put flyers. I'm telling you. It hasn't been lack of traffic, but I cannot tell you why we can't crack that thing of having them come. But we have traced that some of it is that now it's like that Johnny Cash, right? High, high is the water mama, 5 feet rising and just 10 feet away. The problem is getting bigger and bigger with these tort claims that are coming in. We are now at 347 Whoa. Tort claims, and we're starting to see that correlation between okay, they got children over here, and some of these children ain't been tested. So, you know, that's the inherent danger. That's the inherent danger. If we do not capture this information out, when we eventually go to court, we won't have this battle to fight. So I ask you guys that if you can also sit with us and form an alliance, that we go in as allies and try, because you can reach populations that we can't, okay? And I can see that frankly in this room. And I'm saying that if we can capture all that information, when it's all said and done, as soon as the people gonna pack up, they're gonna say they do cleaning, they're gonna go here, they're gonna go there, people are gonna move, and if we do not have this data afterwards, then we're gonna be in a fight with one hand tied behind our back. Keisha?
I just wanted to say that I think it was Saturday, they were getting ready to do a canvassing of the West Calumet housing, and they found out that there was a site set up at Raleigh Park that no one knew about. Mm-hmm. I've had my children tested, you know, but a lot of people didn't know that it was set up at Raleigh Park because it wasn't at the 151st Center. So I can't speak for everyone. Mm-hmm. I can just speak for the people that I talk to, yes, or the people that I try and reach out to, yeah, that we didn't know that they were still doing testing at Raleigh Park as of Saturday. Yep. So if is it possible for maybe something else to be sent out?
Like I say, I'm open for suggestions. Cause like I said, we did Facebook, Twitter, flyers. Part of the mailers with EPA go directly to them.
See, we don't know that.
But if you got something that you guys got that works successfully for you that we ain't doing, please share it with us, because our intent is to reach everybody affected. The kids, we got to get to them.
Mayor, as you know, we met with the governor's staff as well, and they had addressed us and said, to get emergency funds, we need the mayor to request, the governor to request.
And that's what I did with the lieutenant governor.
Okay, you requested emergency disaster funds.
And I told you that now I'm getting ready to do the same thing
with
governor-elect. I'm getting ready to ask, because the one thing, he left me, and the beautiful thing is, he left me with his personal number, okay? And I called it, his kids have the phone. Daddy, telephone, he didn't have to go that far, okay? So I'm saying that, thought I was talking to the lieutenant governor, who I knew and showed compassion, and she could attest to that. She was at that meeting. And then, like I say, with Dr. Jerome Adams, he is putting forth a way of tracking them throughout. They're saying the mere fact that they qualify for these vouchers, and the vouchers are trackable. When we layer that upon the testing, and we know where they're at because the vouchers fixing the sites, and they got to constantly petition to ask for the vouchers to come in, that if we mesh this together, according to Dr. Adams, that we can put a fairly good tracking system in order.
Mayor, what I'd like to say to you, first of all, I want to thank you in advance for, you want to get almost down there, the main thing that I want to thank you for, and I'm going to say this, because I'm going to put God in the midst of everything that I do.
Please do.
Because first of all, the sincerity and the severity of the situation is my concern. We have, for the seniors, you know, they, after all, we are testing positive. I tested positive, and I have luck also. I have a lot of concerns right now. I'm asking you, and I'm going to thank you in advance, because we do need someone to come and test those seniors, because a lot of those people can't get out and go to the center to be tested.
Okay.
So we do need someone to come in and see the number of people that are testing positive. We have people that are testing as high as 5.8 for lead. I even tested positive for arsenic. I have my paperwork with my doctor.
Okay. Well, the one thing, surely if they can make the enclosure a holding place, so then we surely can put an on-site thing in. And again, watch this. The beauty of communication. Something so simple, okay. Think about something that simple. But can it be done? Yes, it can.
Yeah, it can.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
You heard it, right, lady? You heard it, doctor? Okay, we will say, mobile unit, can we put mobile units in?
We are working with state to try to do more direct efforts.
Oh, okay.
So,
and could you explain, we went from asking to come and say, we went mobile, now we're going back to blood draws.
Yes.
Okay. Because the blood draws is more intense and more accurate than just doing the finger prick. So, out of my lips to your ears, we're going to do an on-site blood draw at the Nicosia building.
Amen.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor.
Mayor Copeland, I would personally like to thank you on behalf of the strategy team and all of us that are here, I would thank each and every one of you for coming out and hearing our demands and everything. And I look forward to hearing from you soon.
And I too, and I'm not going to share with them my secret that we have. We have this, she was born a precinct person and a very active precinct person that stayed in my ear and what administrator. Is that every time you call me that I didn't address what you want?
No, sir.
That's just how I'm designed. I feel if a person called me, then if they took the time to do it, then I surely have to rise to that equal level. I pride myself not to be above people, nor beneath the people. That's why I can look in the eye.